Hey NACA, I'm Joey Kramer, the drummer with Aerosmith. In the next few minutes, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the band and the experiences that I've had over the last 40 years. I offer a brutally candid look at the real guy behind the drum kit, an outwardly tough rock star whose frenetic drumming and wild ways mask some deep-seated trauma, even deeper than the alcohol and the drug addictions that I finally kicked. I share a story about how I managed to rise to the pinnacle of professional success and popular acclaim in spite of suffering from depression and anxiety after years of physical and emotional abuse from my father. I tell audiences about the nervous breakdown that I experienced at the height of my band's comeback success. My goal is to convey the message that it's okay to acknowledge vulnerability and that seeking help is a sign of strength, not weakness.
All in all, man, there's a lot of influence. It turned me on to a lot of really good stuff.
Yeah. I was a drummer in another band, and I think he sensed, or if he doesn't, I gotta be honest with you now, I've always been jealous. But by being a drummer, I've opened the door into, like, being the deputy director of the universe.
Yeah, man, but you opened a lot of doors for me.
You remember, we took Walk This Way one step further.
You were in this little line, this little groove of where you were going as a drummer, but then you stopped because you wanted to sing. And you kind of turned me onto that line, and I just accelerated and took it all the way.
And look at us now.
Here we are.
His playing is big.
Well, he's really loud.
Tenacious.
Awesome.
Sweet.
You know, loud.
Scenic.
The meter is pegged.
Crazy.
F***ed.
And it's quite obvious we were supposed to be together and do this.
Get it!
You wonder how much fate played a role.
I thought I wanted to go to Berklee School of Music. I went to Berklee for about 3 weeks. I was living in an apartment with two other guys that went to Berklee. I was down on Newbury Street one day in a leather store who a friend of mine, Raymond, had, and he told me about these two guys that he knew that were moving down from New Hampshire and wanted to start a band.
We were looking around for a drummer to replace the drummer that we had up in New Hampshire.
He came in and he had technique. You know, I mean, he was polished.
He came to rehearsals at BU West Campus 1, the girls' dormitory there, and played. And I thought to myself, wow, man, I don't have to play the drums. And he kind of just on the natch sat down and played and laid the beat down real tight because he'd been working with the Black Soul Band. You know, so there's the magic right there.
I had the name Aerosmith tucked away from the time I was in high school. I used to jot it down in all my books from the time I was in 10th or 11th grade. You know, I knew. We weren't anything before we were Aerosmith. We were Aerosmith right from the get-go.
When we're playing live, it's like, it's the engine. You know, it's the team of horses that pulls everything else through the mud.
To be on stage with that, it's just such a powerful sound. It's intoxicating. It really is.
It just gets right through all everything else, and that's all I need to hear.
The power that lies in the seat that I sit in on stage is extraordinary. It is the only seat in the house that has a bird's eye view of everything that's going on. I get to see the band in action. I get to see the audience interact with one another. I get to see the other guys in my band interact with each other, as well as interact with me.
Joey and I just have a lot of eye contact during a show that people probably don't even notice. Or whether one of us screws up, and then it's like, you know, the first thing I do is I look around at Joey and see if he caught me, and, you know, he'll look at me like, you know, gotcha. A lot of people ask how we kept together all this time, and I have really no idea.
Whoa! Whoa, yeah!
Managing the longevity in this band has definitely been one of the major hurdles in my life.
I have so much respect for him at so many levels. I mean, emotionally, I'll even start there now as an older man in rock and roll. Just to, I think I know what he's probably gone through just to keep a band together for 30 years, to be around those people. I have so much respect for him as a man. Then we can even talk about the playing later. But that's the first, I gotta go there first. That's a hell of a lick to keep a band together that long.
And when we came back together in 84, it was a time of everybody realizing via a new manager that we had that the drugs especially had to be cut from our lives. And one at a time over the course of like 3 years, we all became sober. I always knew in my heart that Aerosmith was just too strong an entity to just go poof in a night.
When I lost my grip and I hit the floor, yeah, I thought I could leave, but couldn't get out of the room.
We have, you know, a great fascination and a love for the music that seems to override.
We always seem to let the music pull us through.
Loving in that lobita, living it up when I'm going down.
Well, the band's just a series of ups and downs. There's a lot of pushing and pulling, and we make every mistake 3 times, and hopefully we learn from them and come back.
Joey was unable to come to the original sessions for 9 Lives.
There was a period of time for me where I was actually entertaining, you know, do I still want to do this anymore? I went into a really deep depression, which is something that I had never experienced before. It had just a profound effect on me where I had to go away and deal with it, you know, in treatment.
He's hung in there through times that most drummers would have left.
The album, in the meantime, was being started because we had been involved in pre-production for the 6 months before that.
We had the experience of not having him there in a creative process, and we had a studio player there who was one, the top notch, but it's just not the same.
He's works with the band, you know. He's in there. It's his band. Band's as good as his drummer, and he's the drummer with Aerosmith.
You know, if you take one of the cogs out of the transmission, it just changes the whole thing.
They said, you know, we want to go back in and redo all the tracks, and obviously we want you to play on them, you know. And I didn't know whether or not I was ready to do that at the time, because I didn't know whether I was strong enough. You know, I was still dealing with a lot of issues.
We all got around and supported him and told him, reminded him, you know, how essential he was to other albums and how much. You know, Aerosmith wouldn't be Aerosmith without his drums.
So I went back into the studio, mustered up the strength that I could. I schooled on all the songs as hard as I could, put all my other shit aside, and I knew that if I came up on the bright side of this and did the tracks the way I knew I could do them, that everything would be fine and I'd be happy with them.
He's a great example for us all as a player and as someone who is more than a survivor of that whole lifestyle, but an overcomer. And he's really, really a real strong one. And he's really someone that I think can teach all of us on a lot of levels, as a drummer and as a person.
Mr. Kramer on the drums!
The guy that plays drums in my band, you know.
I think the best part about working with Joey is he's a good friend, and he's always there.
He really wants to make a heart-to-heart connection with people.
But he's the strongest person with the biggest heart out of anybody in the band. He still calls people up and reminds them that it's the other guy's birthday. So, you know, you can't even bottle that.
He's a mate.
The best thing that happens for me through all of this is that I get to play the drums.